How many of you truly, truly love the Lord? Hallelujah. How many of you here are in love with the Lord? Amen. We need to be totally in love with the Lord. Not infatuated with the Lord. Not just in awe of the things He can do. He can do great things because He's a great God. But we need to be in love with Him. Can we pray? Father, we thank You. Oh, we honor You in this place. We thank You for Your Son, Jesus. Lord Jesus, we thank You. We thank You, Holy Spirit, that You're in the midst of us. And we thank You that Your presence and Your power and Your anointing is here in the midst of us this morning. Lord, we thank You that it's the anointing that breaks the yoke, and every yoke of bondage, I speak and decree, would be broken now in the name of Jesus, and not just by those here, but those that are watching. I thank You, Lord, that Your peace reigns, and that, Holy Spirit, You reveal Yourself even greater to us this morning. Allow us to be sensitive to You this morning. I thank You that our hearts and our minds are prepared to receive the living, incorruptible seed, the Word this morning, that it's going to spring up and bear much fruit in our lives quickly. And we thank You for it. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a shout. Good morning if you're viewing by way of Ustream this morning. I know the Lord's going to bless you this morning. And I have a good word for you all this morning. You know what that word is? Jesus. Jesus is the word. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. I love God. And I love the way the Holy Spirit does things. Right? How many of you love the Holy Spirit?
Amen.
The Holy Spirit loves you. But I love how He does things. You know, I got to bed last night at 3 o'clock. Probably fell asleep around 3:30. And, you know, had all my notes ready and prepared. But this morning, you know, God rearranged something. And what I'm going to start off with this morning is not the beginning of my notes. It's something that's not even in my notes. So I love when He does that. And then when He does that, He brings confirmation to it. So, praise God. So, if you have a Bible, follow along with me. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. When you get there, say amen. And I'm going to be reading it off my phone. Thank God for technology. Second Corinthians chapter 1, starting at verse 1. You there?
Amen.
I'm going to be reading from the Voice translation. And it says, Paul, an emissary of Jesus, the Anointed, pressed into service by the will of God, and our brother Timothy to God's church that gathers in Corinth, and all the saints in the region of Achaia. May grace and peace from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus, the Anointed One, surround you. All praise goes to God, Father of our Lord Jesus, the Anointed One. For He is the Father of compassion, the God of all comfort. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
He consoles us when we endure the pain and the hardship of life, so that we may draw from His comfort and share it with others in their struggles. So God says that we go through hard times, and in the hard times we experience His comfort. The reason why we experience His comfort is so we can turn around and help those that are going through hard times and share in the comfort of God that He has given us. Is that what that just said? Amen. Verse 5, and even as His suffering continues to flood over us, through the Anointed, we experience the wealth of His comfort just the same. If we are afflicted with such trouble and pain, then know it is so that you might ultimately experience comfort and salvation. If we experience comfort, it is to encourage you so that you can hold up while you endure the same sufferings we share. Verse 7, unshaken and unshakable. That's because we know that as you share in our sufferings, so you will also share in our comfort. Verse 8, my brothers and sisters, we have to tell you that when we were in Asia, the troubles we faced were nearly more than we can handle. You ever feel that way?
Yes.
That the troubles that you're going through are more than you can handle. The burdens we bore nearly crushed us. Our strength dwindled down to nothing. Can anyone relate?
Yes.
For a while, we weren't even sure if we would make it through the whole ordeal. Verse 9. We thought we would have to serve out our death sentences right then and there. As a result, we realized, say Revelation, we realized that we could no longer rely on ourselves. We could no longer rely on ourselves. And that we must trust solely in God, who possesses the power to raise the dead. Miraculously, God himself delivered us from the cold hands of death. We again place our hope in him alone, and we know he will deliver us. Join us in this work. Lend us a hand through prayer so that many will give thanks for the gift that comes to us when God answers the prayers of so many. Hallelujah. So God is saying that many times his people go through hardship and his people go through troubles, his people go through pressure. Anyone ever feel some pressure? And in the midst of that, God will comfort us so we can use the experience of God comforting and healing us to help others. But nonetheless, a lot of times when we go through these struggles, we try to depend upon ourselves. We think we can handle it. We think that we have the insight and we think we have the wisdom and we think we have the know-how to handle it. But this is saying in these hard times, and there are hard times coming, that we need not to rely on self, but we need to trust totally in God.
Amen.
Can you say amen?
Amen?
Now, we've been ministering on evangelism. Correct? We've been trying to motivate you all to begin to evangelize. And this message is still about evangelism. But the title of the message is called, What Are You Relying On? Say that with me. What am I relying on? Let me say this. If you rely upon self, you're not going to do it. You're not going to reach out to those lost. You're not going to be obedient to the word that you heard this morning. You need to trust God and walk in the Spirit. Do you know that to walk in the Spirit of God, it is impossible to do it by natural means? You cannot walk in the Spirit by willpower. You cannot walk in the Spirit in your own strength. You need to be in the Spirit to walk in the Spirit, depending upon the Holy Spirit and trusting God upon His Word. Can you say hallelujah? Turn to Proverbs chapter 3. We're going to read Proverbs chapter 3 from the Message Bible. How many of you want to comfort others? How many of you want to be used by God? How many of you are already being used by God? And here's the great thing about God. God is not a respecter of persons. He doesn't care what color you are. He doesn't care what your culture is. He doesn't care if you're tall or short. He doesn't care if you're fat or skinny. I know he doesn't want us fat, but, right? And he doesn't care if you're young or old. God wants to use you. Proverbs chapter 3 in the Message. The subtitle for this chapter says this, don't assume you know it all. Turn to your neighbor and say that. Don't assume that you know it all. How many know-it-alls do we have here? I have found in the 35, 36 years of ministry, every person I knew that knew it all knew nothing.
Yeah.
There's a whole lot of authorities on nothing. And they're professional. And they're good at it. Good friend. Now, I'm going to stop here because most other translations don't say friend. It says son. And we have to understand the book of Proverbs, Solomon wrote to his son. But as by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, the book of Proverbs is from our Father God written to us. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're a son. Even the women, you're a son, right? So good friend, my son, don't forget all that I've taught you. Take to heart my commands. They'll help you live a long, long time. How many of you want to live a long life? Hallelujah. They will help you live a long, long time. A long life lived full and well. Don't lose your grip on love and loyalty. Now, in the Message Bible, as well as other translations, love and loyalty are capitalized because they refer to the name of a person. God is love, and God is faithful, right? So we're talking about don't lose your grip on Jesus. Don't lose your grip on Jesus, the Word of God. What does it mean to have a grip? You ever go on a roller coaster?
That's me.
And you don't let go because you're going to fall out, you know? Don't let go of your grip. Don't lose the grip on love and loyalty. Tie them around your neck. Carve their initials upon your heart. How many of you have carved initials in a tree or in public school on your desk? Repent. Right? You carved your initials in a tree of the one you love, correct? You don't carve the initials of your enemies. You carve the initials of those you love and hold dear. Carve the initials on your heart. Earn a reputation. Say reputation.
Reputation.
Earn a reputation for living well in God's eyes as well as in the eyes of people. Trust God from the bottom of your heart and do not try to figure out everything on your own. Listen for God's voice in everything you do, everywhere you go. He is the only one who will keep you on track. Don't assume that you know it all. Run to God. Run from evil. Your body will then glow with health. Your very bones will vibrate with life. Honor God with everything you own. Give him the first and the best. Your bonds will burst. Your wine vats will brim over. But don't, dear friends, resent God's discipline. Don't sulk under his loving correction. It's the child that he loves that God corrects. A father's delight is behind all of this. Amen? So we have been told that we need to trust God. We need to trust in God and not rely upon ourselves. If you're going to do natural things like rake the grass, you can depend upon your natural abilities. But if you're going to go forth and spread revival to this land, you can't do it in your own strength. As a matter of fact, if you do it in your own strength, you won't even be able to spark the fire to create the inferno of your revival. You won't even go forth and lead the first person to Christ if you're doing it in your own strength. You need to totally depend upon God and trust God to do this. Now, that doesn't mean you're going to sit over here and you're going to go, I'm going to be quiet, and God is just going to lift me out of my shoes and just levitate me through the front doors and drop me right in front of a person that needs to be saved. Of course, you need to put actions to your faith because without faith, it's impossible to please God. And the thing about faith, it's not faith unless you do it. But you need to do it in the spirit, not in your flesh, not in your own strength, not in your own ability. You need to walk in the obedience and the power and the anointing of God to go forth and bring life to death. Can you say amen? Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, New Living Translation says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding, but seek His will in all that you do, and He will show you which path to take. Now, I truly believe that the body of Christ today has a trust issue. I truly believe that the body of Christ today has a trust issue. They have no problem trusting in everything they're not supposed to. Turn to your neighbor and say, "You awake?" Hallelujah. I love y'all, but I don't like silence. I know you're listening, okay? But we have a trust issue in the body of Christ. Do we truly trust God? Do we truly trust God and His Word? Do we truly believe that the Word of God applies to us? If I had to say by the actions of many people in the body of Christ, I would probably say no. I think people put more trust and more belief in everything that's wrong with them than they do with God. I'll give you an example. A person who is afraid puts more trust in fear than they do God. Would you agree?
Yes.
A person who struggles with infirmities or oppression in their mind put more faith in those things than they do God. Now, granted, there are some people who are walking out their healing, but there are some people that just accept it. This is how I am. This is how I'm always going to be. And we need to break that lie, because it comes down to this. And this is one of the things we teach on Monday night. Whatever you're trusting in is either a lie or a truth. Whatever you're trusting in is either a lie or a truth. And if God's word says that you could be one way, but you behave another way, and you don't think there's hope or help for you, your trust is in self. You are relying on yourself, and you are not relying and depending upon God. You're not even trusting the Holy Spirit who dwells in you. So trust is a big factor in our lives. If we're going to walk in power and walk in victory, we need to trust God in our lives. If we're going to lead someone to Christ, listen, you walk up to a stranger, you don't know what they're going to say. You don't know how they're going to react. And the carnal mind, most of the times, thinks they're going to react negatively. Right? Oh, they heard this before. They're going to walk away. They're going to mock. I don't want to get... You know what? God is softening the hearts of the people. As I've been ministering, the Holy Spirit is the one who helps you. The Holy Spirit is the partner here. The Holy Spirit goes ahead and prepares the hearts for the people that you've been praying for to minister to. So when you go and minister, they already have been prepared to receive the word.
Amen?
Amen? Now, do you trust in that?
Yes.
Do you trust in that? Then next week, this place should have 3 times as many people. Right? In a perfect world, right? Well, we live in a perfect world. It's called the supernatural. It is a perfect world. This world is not perfect. This world is far from perfect. But the kingdom of God that reigns in us is perfect. Amen? Turn to your neighbor and say, we really don't have an excuse. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Turn to your neighbor and say, he's talking to me. The New King James Version says it this way: trust in the Lord with your whole heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths, make straight and smooth your paths. The word trust in the Hebrew, the word batak, and it means, properly the word means to high. Say high.
High.
High. H-I-E. High. Not high. It means to high. That's a word that's usually used in poetry. And the word high means to hasten, to move or run with haste. It means to go in speed rapidly. It also means to not waste time. So it's saying, trust in the Lord with your whole heart and lean not. The word trust says that we hide for refuge. When we trust in the Lord, we speedily run to Him. Before we get the opportunity to reason ourselves out of obedience to God, run continually, steadfastly to the place of putting your total reliance upon God and not in yourself. In other words, time's a wasting. Don't let a second go by. When there's a choice, say choice. When there's a choice, you need to immediately run to the place of trust. Trust in God. The word trust also goes on to mean to trust or to be confident or sure. Be confident in the Lord. Be sure in the Lord. Be speedily and steadfast in the Lord. It also means to be bold. Now, are you hearing things this morning that you've already heard spoken? It means to be bold and to be sure. You see, a lot of times, because we don't fully trust God, we do this. I don't know. You see, Pastor Anthony was a pretty smart guy. And Pastor Anthony always used to say this. The devil is out to get us. He's like a roaring lion. He's constantly seeking. He's constantly looking for the opportunity to seize us and get us out of God's will. Right? Isn't that the word? He's our adversary, the devil, who walks around like a roaring lion, seeking who he can devour. And if we give the devil an inch, he takes the whole foot. And if we give the devil a whole foot, he takes the whole mile. So we need not to play with indecision. We need to be steadfast and obedient and do the word. Do the word, because the devil will talk you out of it every time. Can you say, uh-oh? But Pastor Vin, I thought you said the devil was defeated the other day. I thought you said the devil's been placed under our feet. That's right, he has, but why you keep lifting up your foot? Unbelief and doubt does this, because it gets you to step backwards. And as soon as you start stepping backwards, you let them loose. We need to constantly be in the place of authority that I will give no place to the devil. The Bible says we give the devil no place. It doesn't say we don't give the devil most of the place. It says he's evicted and he has zero right in my life. How many want that? It's the reason that Jesus shed his blood, was to forgive you and to empower you. The reason why he's given us the word, so we can build ourselves up in such a great faith that we could speak to mountains and they go. We can speak to devils and they bow. Can lay hands on the sick and watch them recover. And every one of you in this room have the ability to do it. Because the same Holy Spirit that lives in me is the same Holy Spirit that lives in you. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. So we trust in the Lord. That word also means to be confident and sure. Trust. It also means to put your confidence and your hope in. To trust in, to have confidence and to be confident, to be bold and to be secure, to cause to trust and make secure, to feel safe. Say, feel safe. Perilous times, people. Perilous times. In perilous times, if we're walking in the will of God and we're trusting God wholeheartedly, not half-heartedly, we shall find safety. Amen. Hallelujah. Right now, you see what's going on in Israel, right? And we know the hand of God is the dome that's protecting. Amen. There was a story yesterday. Just give me a second. Bear with me 1 second. I want to bless you with something here. There was a story. Just got to open my account here. 2 seconds. Come on, way to go. There we go. There was a story, a headline, and I believe it was from the Jerusalem Telegraph yesterday. And the headlines say this, quoting a terrorist, "Their God changes the path of our rockets in midair." Am I lying? Is that what that says? That's a photograph. Okay? So even though we're in perilous times, We do not fear the arrow by night, or the missiles by night, or the rockets by night, or the arrow by noonday, for it shall not come near your dwelling. Right? Doesn't God say that? So we need to put our trust and confidence, even though we hear that perilous times are coming, and ash and bodies in the streets, and who knows what's coming down the road. But God promised it would not come near you or your dwelling or your family. Right? But, if you don't trust in the Lord, do you disqualify yourself from that protection? Absolutely. I'll tell you why. Because when you don't trust in God, you don't believe Him. And if you don't believe God, you're in disobedience. Because He has commanded us over and over and over again to believe Him, to have faith in Him. When the Word says, have faith in me, it says, believe me what I'm telling you. Unbelief is a sin. Right? So we need to put our trust and reliance in the Most High God. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So we set our hope as well as our confidence upon God. How many of you are self-confident? You ever meet a self-confident person? I mean, some self-confident people just reek, and not in a good way, because their self-confidence is really pride, right? But our confidence is God. Our confidence is His Word. Our confidence is based upon the integrity of who God is. God is a God of integrity. Amen?
Amen.
And we need to put our trust in Him. Amen. Psalms 118, verse 8 and 9. Just listen. It says, it is better, say better,
better.
To trust in the Lord than to put your confidence in man. It is better to put your trust in the Lord than it is to put your trust in mankind. I'll say it one other way. It is better to put your trust in the Lord than it is to put your trust in self. Because last time I checked, we were all mankind. Right? It is better to trust the Lord than to put your confidence in princes or government. Those who trust in government, or trust in finances, or trust other people, or even themselves, will be disappointed in the end. Amen. On the other hand, those who put their confidence in God will never be ashamed.
Amen.
Romans 10:11 says, no man who believes in Him, who adheres to and relies on and trusts in Him, will ever be put to shame or be disappointed.
That's right.
Wow. Wow. How many have ever been disappointed? How many of you enjoy it? How would you like to never be disappointed again? We got to put our trust in God. Amen. So we trust in the Lord. We lean not on our own understanding. The word lean in Hebrew, sha'an, means to lean or to support one's self. The Bible says we are not to lean on our own understanding. We are not to support self in our own understanding. In other words, we are not to trust our own wisdom. We are not to trust our feelings. We are not to trust our emotions. We are not to trust our fallen psyche.
Amen.
And many Christians is exactly where they live. They live in the soulish realm. They live in psyche. They live according to their past hurts. They live according to the abuse of their past. They live according to the pains they experience. But we started out talking about that in those pains, we are to walk in the comfort and receive the comfort of God. But if we don't trust God, how are we going to receive anything from God? Here's the thing. The level of your trust is in direct relation to your relationship with God. Because if I was a stranger on the 7 train and I said, hey, you know what? Can I see your wallet for a minute? How many of you are going to give me your wallet? None of you? Why not? Don't you trust me? Don't I have a trusting face? Well, That's a whole nother teaching, sister. That's how shall man rob God. Because that verse, how shall a man rob God, means exactly that. How shall a man burglarize God? Right? But if you knew me, if I asked any one of you if I can hold your wallet, would you hesitate to give me your wallet? Why? Am I going to steal your money? Am I going to steal your identity? No, I don't want your identity. I don't even want my identity. My identity is Christ Jesus. Right? So if I don't get into the place of having an intimate relationship with God, I cannot trust Him. It is impossible to trust God apart from a relationship from Him. So if the body of Christ has a major trust issue, the body of Christ has a lack of relationship with God issue. And we need to grow up and we need to mature. Turn to your neighbor and say, I'm growing. I'm growing, bro. I'm growing. Amen. God is saying that we, His sons and daughters, are not to support our own way of thinking or even our own way of doing things. Many times we seek out those people, our friends, who will support our wrong way of thinking. You know? You know, even in churches, it's amazing. Even in churches, I'm going to sit for a second because I need to sit for this one. Even in churches, leadership finds a common thread. You'll get one person who has a situation in their life, and they'll come to the pastor and they'll say, Pastor, what do you think about this? And the pastor will counsel them according to the word of God. And then they'll go to the next pastor and say, Pastor, what do you think about this? And that pastor will counsel them according to the word of God. Then they'll go to an elder, and the elder will do the same thing. And they'll keep going around because, yeah, those answers are good, but it's not the one I want. It's not the one I want to hear. I want someone to agree with my mess and tell me I have the right to do things my way. The problem is, in the kingdom of God, you gave up your rights when you got saved. You have no rights according to self. Now, walking in righteousness and walking in obedience to God and walking as an ambassador and walking as kings and priests, you receive more than you could ever want. But it's not based upon your rights or because you deserve it. It's based upon the grace and the goodness of God. Because none of us deserve salvation, but yet we saved?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Am I making sense this morning?
Yes.
Hallelujah. So many times we will seek out those who will support the way we think or will kind of give credence. You have the right to feel this way in your emotions. Don't create that ungodly alliance with anyone. And if someone comes to you, and usually they come to you with a complaint, usually they come to you with a murmur, usually they come with a little bit of gossip, shut them down. And say, sister, brother, trust in the Lord. I didn't get too many amens on that one. Why? Because the spiritual application is this power in agreement. If two or three agree according to the will of God, God's will is done. But if two or three come together and agree on the will of the devil, the will of the devil's done. And you know what? Self is based upon devilish wisdom, carnal thinking, corrupt emotions. So when I say it's coming into agreement with the devil, it actually is. Amen? Turn to your neighbor and say, I want to grow. Learning something this morning? Now here's the thing. It says we don't lean on our own understanding, but in all of our ways, we acknowledge God. Turn to your neighbor and say, how many ways do you have? In all of our ways, we acknowledge God. The word here is derech, and the word ways means road. But figuratively, it means the course of life. In every course of our life, we are to acknowledge God. In every mode of action, we are to acknowledge God. In every conversation, we are to acknowledge God. And here's a tricky one, because life and death is in the tongue. And if you're not acknowledging God, and we're going to talk about the word acknowledge in a minute, if God isn't the focus of what you're speaking, then you're speaking the opposite of trusting God. You're trusting in circumstances. You're trusting in situations. You are not trusting in supernatural. You are trusting in natural. And you know, we think it's not a big deal. But the Word of God says that the strongest member in our entire body is our tongue. And it's like the rudder of a ship that will steer the course of your life. The things you speak about, the things you talk about, the things you joke about, the things that you put people down about is going to steer the direction of your life. The Bible says we need to align aright our conversation. And conversation doesn't mean chitter-chatter. It also means the manner in which we live. Why? Because in the abundance of our heart, our mouth speaks. Amen? It also means in our customs. We have to acknowledge God in our customs, in our manners, in our habits, in our impulses. How many have ever done something impulsively? Did you regret it? Whenever we do something according to impulse, there's going to be regret. Right? You all know the story of the cup of coffee in 7-Eleven. Right? I gave in to an impulse when I threw my coffee. I threw my coffee, but I repented, brother. It wasn't at anyone. It was just, it's a long story. I've told it before. I'll tell you afterwards if you really want to know. I mean, I'm not ashamed of it, but it's under the blood. So. Little frustration. The man wouldn't give me a cup that wouldn't leak, so I threw the coffee. Not at him. Just threw it in the store. Yeah. It was just a humbling moment in my life. But you know what I did immediately? It was a long time ago. It was probably 12 years ago. Maybe 12, 14. Oh, we were married when I did that? Okay. Yes, you're right. We were. But I did the right thing. I immediately picked up the phone and I brought it into accountability. I told somebody what I did. I didn't hide my sin. I didn't cover my sin. I wanted not to have that to have a foothold in my life. Amen. So I brought it into a place of being accountable. And that's why I'm open about it. Right? Not that I boast in the fact that I threw a cup of coffee. That's not something to boast about. Something to hide about. That's my biggest sin. That's the only sin I've ever committed. Okay, I have to repent again now. Thank you, Ma. I can't trust in you. Okay. Anyway, the book of Proverbs, chapter 16, verse 7. Right? And this is the scripture Pastor Teresa used last week, and she even used it this morning. Thank God for confirmation. In the expanded Bible, it says, when people live so that they please the Lord, people's paths draw to the Lord's favor. Even their enemies make peace with them. So when we walk in a way that pleases God, that opens the door for God's favor. The Message Bible says, when God approves of your life, even your enemies will end up shaking your hand. The Voice, when people make good choices, He is pleased. Amen? So are we learning something here? So in all of our ways, we acknowledge Him. But before we get to acknowledge, turn to 2 Corinthians 5. Second Corinthians 5, verses 9 and 10, and this is the Phillips translation. Oh, you got to love Bible Gateway. You there? Verse 9 says it this way, it is our aim, therefore, to please Him, whether we are at home or away. For every one of us will have to stand without pretense before Christ our judge. And we shall be rewarded for what we did when we lived in our bodies, whether it was good or bad. The word pleasing here, please or pleasing, depending upon what version you have, is the Greek word eurastos, and it means to be fully agreeable. So it is our aim, therefore, to be fully agreeable with God. Amen. Fully, not partially. It is our goal and our aim to be fully pleasing to God. Fully agreeable, or what is acceptable or accepted and well-pleasing to God. How many of you want to be well-pleasing?
Amen.
Amen. Now the word acknowledge. Trust in the Lord with your whole heart. Lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways, all your course of life, all your conversations, all the things you think about, acknowledge Him. And the word acknowledge here is yada in the Hebrew, and it means to know. It means to know. That's the same type of connotation of the word, if you know the truth makes you free. In all your ways, you need to know God. And you need to know His thinking. And you need to know His thought patterns. And you need to know His decision. But most importantly, you need to be intimate with Him in every decision you make. The word also goes on to mean causatively instruction. So the reason we need to know God in every decision and every thought is because God will give you the proper direction to take. Because acknowledge Him in all your way, and He directs your paths. Can you say amen? How many of you want to know God greater?
Amen.
This word acknowledge also goes on to say, to be acquainted with, to comprehend, to consider and declare, to be diligent, and to cause discernment. It means to be familiar with and to have friendship with. We need to make sure that we are on the friendly side of God in every decision we make. Right? Hallelujah. It means to know, to learn to know, to perceive and to see, to find out and to discern, to know by experience, to recognize, to admit, to be acquainted with, to know a person carnally. To know a person carnally. Does anyone not know what that means? To know someone carnally means sexually. Okay, but now God's not saying He wants you to have sex with Him. Okay, but God wants you to be intimate with Him. That's right. Such a deep, intimate, personal level of intimacy with God. Right? We need to be intimately acquainted with God before we make a decision. But it has to be done so fast, because trusting Him is immediate. We've got to do it quickly. Can't waste any time. I need to get in His presence. I need to know Him. I need to experience His love. I need to experience His power. I need to experience His love. I need to experience His comfort, and I need it right now. And you are able to receive it right now. Right now. Unless you don't believe it, then you'll struggle with it. Amen? Hallelujah. The example of the word know is very simple in the Hebrew. It says Adam knew his wife. She bore a child. Right? Sarah. Abraham knew Sarah, and she bore Isaac. It's the same word, knowing. The Common English Bible translation says, trust in the Lord with your whole heart. Don't rely on your own intelligence. Don't rely on your own smarts. Don't rely on what you learned in school. School. School is cool. Right? You need to learn what the Holy Spirit teaches you. Amen? Know Him in all your paths, and He will keep your way straight. Trusting in the Lord, number one, is having a submissive attitude. It's having an attitude of submission. What is that? Humility and gratitude. Humility and gratitude make up the attitude for submission. Trusting in God equals submission. Trusting in self, self-willed, is pride. And self-will and pride equal rebellion to God's will, God's purpose, and God's plan. Trusting only and completely in God will always equal victory in your life.
Amen?
Amen? Want me to say that again for those taking notes? Trusting in the Lord is having a submissive attitude. Humility and gratitude make up the attitude of submission. Trusting fully in God is submission. Trusting in self, trusting in your old ways, trusting in preconceived ideas, trusting in religious concepts, trusting in religious tradition is really self-will and pride. And that equals rebellion to the will of God as well as his purpose and plan for your life. Trusting only and completely in God will always equal victory. Can you say amen? Let's talk a little bit more about submission. By the way, for those in Victorious Overcomers, doesn't this sound familiar? According to Noah Webster, as Pastor Anthony used to call him, Brother Webster, the definition for the word submission, if you want to take notes, I recommend. There's five definitions for submission here. Number one, the act of submitting, or the act of yielding to power or authority. Is God power? Is God authority? Amen. Are his leaders power and authority? Right? Government, leaders, powers. Listen, I did a whole teaching on being under the authority of God, right? Yeah. I don't need to reteach it right now. So the act of submitting is the act of yielding to power or authority. It means to surrender, the surrender of the person and power to the control or government of another. The control or the rule of another. Got it? Number two, in order for us to be submitted, there has to be an acknowledgement of inferiority. You have to acknowledge that you don't have all the answers. You have to acknowledge that you don't know what you're doing. You have to come under new management. Okay? Acknowledgement of inferiority or dependence. In other words, we need to surrender and submit, and that's the only way we can get dependent upon God. The only way we will have true dependency upon God is when we are out of the picture. You understand? When we step away from the throne of our life and allow him to be the king on that throne. It also means humble or succumbent behavior. Number three, submission is the acknowledgement of a fault, confession, or error. Like I confessed, I threw coffee in a 7-Eleven. Right? When we fall into the place of sin or disobedience, we need to get it right with God immediately. And I recommend to bring it to one of your leaders. That way you bring it into an accountability in your life. Men who deal with pornography need to bring that to their leaders so they can keep you accountable. What does that mean? They will be checking up on you and they will be seeing if you're still struggling in those areas. And they will love you and they will comfort you and they will correct you and they will realign you and rotate your tires and change your oil if needed. Okay? They will do whatever it takes to see you walk in freedom. Okay? Right? So acknowledgement of the fault, the confession, or even error. Number four, submission means obedience. Say obedience. And obedience is compliance with the commands or laws of a superior. Submission of children to their parents is an indispensable duty. In the teaching I did on being under God's authority, I talked about no matter if your ruler is sweet or harsh, we have to be obedient to them. Even if you have the greatest parents on earth, or your parents are the worst parents on earth, you still need to be in submission and respect their authority. What you don't have to do is obey their commands that go directly against the Bible. Amen? But you still have to respect their authority. Hey, before you were saved, did you have life figured out? And if they ain't saved, well, have some mercy and compassion. Maybe your act of humility will be the very thing to touch their life. Maybe you acting in love instead of having a bad attitude will cause them to change. You know why? Because as a man sows, he reaps. Number five, resignation. Is that a confirmation? I'm sorry. Submission is a resignation. It's a yielding of one's will or appointment of a superior without murmuring. the yielding of one's will or appointment of a superior without murmuring. So when your boss says, I need you to work overtime this weekend, who the heck do you think you are? Tell me what to do. Why don't you do it yourself? You're not trusting God. You're not trusting God. Because God has that person over your life. Maybe to straighten out your attitude. I don't know. You know you better than I know you in most cases, right? Entire and cheerful submission to the will of God is a Christian duty of prime excellence. Can you say amen? Now, coming to a close here. How long am I going for, Tom? 45 minutes, good. Our desire is to be pleasing to the Lord, but we have to overcome the hindrances within ourselves to please God. Turn to your neighbor and say, you are your own worst enemy. You are your own worst enemy. You are a bigger threat to your future than even the devil is to your future. You are a bigger threat to your future than the devil is. Why? Because the devil has been rendered powerless and he's under your feet. But sometimes our head doesn't want to believe it. And sometimes our head puts its trust in the hurts and the failures of yesterday. Or I'll never do this because I've been hurt by that. In plain English, that's pretty stupid thinking. Without being offensive. You know, I see on Facebook all the time women that have been in abusive relationships. You know they've been in an abusive relationship because every single picture they put up is about how bad men are, you know? And I'll never let a guy do that to me again. And I'll never get in a relationship with another guy again. I'm going to live celibate for the rest of my life because men stink. No, you stink. Because that's not the plan and purpose of God. You understand? If we formulate our future based upon hurts, shame on you. Shame on you, you're letting the devil steal. Turn to your neighbor and say, ah, chihuahua. Right? We're the body of Christ and Jesus is the head, correct? That means we have the mind of Christ. We have to continually move forward with a progressive renewing of our mind. A progressive renewing of psuche, a progressive renewing of our intellect, our will, our emotions, our thoughts, our conscious thoughts, our subconscious thoughts, our hurts, our pains, and our sufferings. We need to be free from fear. We need to be free from our self-image. Right? Tom talked all about it, right? Mm-hmm. Our image is not on self. We are holy in God's sight. Do you see yourself as holy? If you see yourself as holy, you know how you'll behave? Holy. Amen? Relationship is always based upon communication and trust in God. We say we have a relationship with God, yet the things that we deal with in reality are the things that we are truly trusting and submitting. Let's put God first and trust in Him. Amen? When we acknowledge Him in all of our ways, He directs our paths. In closing, the last scripture, Isaiah 26, 3 and 4. Is it hot in here?
Yes.
It's hot in here. Isaiah 26, 3, you there?
Yes.
It says, you will guard him and keep him in perfect and constant peace, whose mind, both its inclination, which is feelings, predispositions, and leaning, as well as its character, is stayed on you. Say stayed. What does it mean to be stayed? One translation says fixed upon God. Well, a fighter jet, when it wants to shoot down another fighter jet in a dogfight, needs to get into position and maneuver until he's locked on target. That target is now fixed, and nothing can break it. He's able to pull that trigger, and that missile will now continue to follow that plane wherever it goes and shoot it out of the sky. We need to have our mind fixed on the Word of God. We need to have our mind fixed upon the ways of God. We need to have our mind, our emotions, our feelings, our thoughts, and the things we think about and the things we meditate has got to be upon the Word of God. That's the only way you're going to develop true trust in Him. You will guard him and keep him in perfect and constant peace. whose mind is fixed and stayed upon you. Because he commits himself to you, he leans on you, and his hope is confidently in you. So trust in the Lord, commit yourself to him, lean on him, hope confidently in him forever. For the Lord God is an everlasting rock, the rock of ages. Amen. How many of you desire to trust God more? Amen. In these end days, if we aren't trusting God, we're going to have some issues. We're going to have some problems. Amen. As we watch what's taking place in Israel, I said it last week, when the enemy attacks Israel, simultaneously the enemy attacks the church. There is always a consistent parallel of what takes place in Israel to what takes place in the church. Amen. The devil is looking to destroy. The devil is looking to divide. The devil is looking to make you ineffective, and the devil, most importantly, is trying to take away your credibility. Say credible. We are to be credible Christians that are walking in love. Are we perfect Christians? Unfortunately, no. But are we striving for perfection? And the way we strive for perfection is by walking and trusting God and trusting the leaders that God has placed in your life and really putting your confidence in him. So in these perilous times, we know we're protected. And in this perilous time, we know that we can usher in the next move of God. How many of you want to be used in the next move of God? Well, the next move of God has begun. It's already begun. We need to step into it. And not a single one of us are exempt from doing it. Amen? Greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. The greater one lives in you. God gave us a command. He gave us a commission to go ye. Say ye. Ye mean me. Go me into all the world. Go me into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Every creature. That doesn't mean chickens and dogs and pigs. Okay? You can practice on them. Practice on your dog. I think we're getting Maxwell to the place where he's finally about to get saved. He's going to get delivered from that Shiba Inu spirit. Yeah, he's a cat trapped in a dog's body. So he needs deliverance. But anyway, listen, we can do it, people. We need to put our trust and hope and confidence in him. We need to rely upon him as if our life depends upon it. Amen. Yes, Derek. Isaiah 26, 3 and 4, and that was the Amplified Bible. Amen. Bow your heads. Father, we thank you. We thank you that each and every one of us heard your word this morning, and I thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are ministering to everyone here right now. Lord, I thank you for your anointing breaks every yoke of bondage, every yoke of fear, every yoke of self-doubt, every yoke of insecurity, every yoke of low self-esteem, every hurt is broken off their lives now. I even loose upon them now the revelation knowledge of the truth as you speak the truth to them, that they would know your voice and they would move in obedience quickly, steadfastly, that they would be quick to obey. I thank you, Father, for even putting people in their lives this week that they can minister the truth and bring salvation to those that don't know you, O God. I thank you for the revival starting in our hearts. I thank you that you begin to kindle and rekindle the fires. Lord, even those that have been saved for so long, that you even restore back the zeal and the excitement when they first came to you, O God, that they would go forth as a mighty army taking this land, O God. Father, I even thank you for supernatural increase and multiplication upon the lives of everyone listening, everyone who hears my words now, that they would even move with the spirit of multiplication, that they would go forth and multiply. I thank you. Satan, I remind you and take great delight that you are a defeated foe, that you have been rendered powerless, that you have been disarmed and you have been defeated, and you're nothing more than a powerless worm by the blood of Jesus. So I just take authority over your lies and I cancel them out with the truth. For God has called a great and mighty people for such a time as this to accomplish mighty exploits in the Lord Jesus Christ. If you receive it, shout amen. Amen. Come on, give the Lord a praise this morning. Hallelujah. If you're here this morning and you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, or maybe you're watching by way of Ustream, I want to let you know that God loves you and that you mean more to God than anything else. He loves you. He desires to know you personally. He desires for you to hear his voice on a constant, daily basis. If you never gave your life to the Lord, maybe you were raised in a religion, maybe you go to church, maybe you don't go to church, that's irrelevant right now. What you need to understand, this is not about a religion. This is about a two-way communication relationship with God. You speak to God, God speaks back to you. You have a question, God has an answer. And he gives you a desire to know him. If you would like to know him in that intimate way, all you have to do is acknowledge the fact that you're a sinner and that Jesus died on a cross for you. If you would just pray with me, say, Heavenly Father, you can pray here right now. As a Heavenly Father, I come to you as I am a sinner. Lord Jesus, I know you died on a cross for me. And you were buried in a tomb and you rose again. Lord Jesus, I invite you into my heart. Fill me with your spirit. Fill me with your presence. Fill me with your power. Forgive me of my sins. Make me your child. Now I desire to know you. Speak to me. Reveal yourself to me. Give me a hunger and a thirst for your word and your spirit. I thank you for saving me, healing me, delivering me, and most importantly, making me your child. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Now, if you prayed that for the first time, I want to give you some good news. Every sin you've ever committed has been washed away by the blood of Jesus Christ. It is impossible for God to ever remember any sin you've ever committed, even if you just did a sin 2 minutes ago. You are brand new in his image. Today is the brand new day. It's the first day of your new life. I want to encourage you to get into a church. I want to encourage you to get into the Word of God. If you have a Bible, start reading in the Gospel of St. John and start reading the book of Proverbs. If you don't have a Bible, contact me. I will be more than happy to send you a Bible in the mail. No obligation, no junk mail, no hounding you, just me loving you. Thank you for tuning in. God bless you. We love you. Hallelujah. How many of you want to walk in victory?